Hey, there we go. Good morning. Ooh. Got a little bit of echo. My name is Jeff Fritz. Welcome back to my live stream. Today is, what day is today? Today is November 2nd, 2018. And we're going to write a little bit of code today. I'm wearing my Heroes of the Storm hat in honor of BlizzCon. Today is the first day of Blizzard's conference, Activision Blizzard, their Blizzard division. It makes a bunch of great games, including my favorite, Heroes of the Storm, Hearthstone, Warcraft, World of Warcraft, Starcraft, and their annual conference and their keynote is today. Under 24 hours to the League of Legends World Finals. Oh, very cool. I tried to get into League and I just couldn't get into it. I don't know. Maybe it's because I got wrapped up in Heroes and I got used to those mechanics. Hey, Tagaron. Good afternoon from Germany. Coded Beard. Reno is here. Shy Sharp. Salaticus. Turrican. Ninja Ola. Hey, Ed. Ed Charbonneau is here. Gareth. Hello, hello. Least Fixed Point. Valve is going to release a Dota card game later this month. Very cool. Very cool to hear that. And Pazotk, right? Am I pronouncing that right? From Denmark. Hello, hello. Let's get some music playing in the background here. I'm going to fire up some music to code by. You know what we haven't played in a while? We haven't played Green. Let's play Green. Yeah, those smooth tunes coming at you live. There we go. Of course, this is music to code by from our friend Carl Franklin. This is scientifically engineered to get you in the groove, get you in the mood, get you completely focused on whatever task it is that you may be working on. And we think it's really terrific, and we get to listen to it here. Each song is about 25 minutes long, about the same length as a Pomodoro. Listen to a song. When the song is done, take a five-minute break. Or if you're running a live stream show, talk to your chat room for 5 minutes. Hello, chat room. But you can always get the latest music from Carl for Music to Code By at mtcb.pwop.com. You can buy the complete album, or you can check out the app at musictoflowby.com. You'll be able to sign up and get a subscription there, and every month or two, he releases a brand new song for you. Is that Swiss Orbma? Thanks so much for that subscription using your Twitch Prime. Of course, I will match and we'll make a donation to Girl Develop It. I see Ed's here. So our friend Ed Charbonneau, there he is in the chat room. Ed's actually started, Ed's been doing some great work and research with the Blazor framework. That's a WebAssembly-based framework that you can use. Write some C#, write some Razor templating, just like we do here server-side, but it gets compiled and runs in the browser using the WebAssembly technology. Ed's going to start on a new series for November called, and he's calling it Neural November. There we go. Blazor and Machine Learning all month long. Very cool, Ed. Best of luck to you in that series. What time will you be starting today? If you want to drop a quick line there in the chat room. In fact, Ed, we're going to test out the shout-out command for you. Let's make sure I spell it right. There you go. So you can click through and you can catch Ed's his stream over there at 12 Eastern time, just about when I'm done here today. Maybe we'll even raid over to Ed when we're done. Hey, Dangeheimer fan. Yes, there. Can I make a shout out to Germany? Guten Nachmittag. There, very cool, Evan. Thanks so much for dropping a follow over there to Ed. All right, let's head over here. 4183 is where we are with our Rainbow Beard Challenge. Oh my gosh. Hey, Swiss Orbma, thanks so much for the follow. Yep, we're pushing closer and closer to 5,000 followers. We get to 5,000 before December 1st. We'll be dyeing my beard rainbow colored for the Dev Intersection Conference. And as you know, Connect is also there. Microsoft Connect, big conference, and I may have a rainbow beard for that event. Alrighty. Some strange stereo experiences, maybe. Il Yazgu, thanks so much for the follow. I appreciate you joining us here on this Friday. Oh my gosh, wait a sec. Didn't we already pick up that follow? Strange things are afoot. I think my green filler lights. There we go. They got moved around. Do I have sessions at these events? I do have. I have a pre-con workshop at Dev Intersection. I have two sessions during the event. In fact, I'm going to be live streaming the second one of those, where I will be showing off Internet of Things capabilities with .NET and JavaScript. We're going to co-present with our friend Noopcat, Suze Hinton. So that'll be a ton of fun. And you'll be able to watch that live here on this channel, also on the Visual Studio channel, and over on Suze's channel with Noopcat. Oh yes, JavaScript. She does great work over there. Look at this. I can drop a shout out to her as well. There we go. So that's Suze Hinton. Check out her stream. She broadcasts on Sunday mornings. I have 5 pull requests out here for Core Wiki, and we're going to take a look at those last today. First thing I want to do... No. First thing I want to do is I want to show you how we fix the shout-out command. We have a potential security vulnerability that we should fix here in Stream Tools. However, it's not published, so I'm not concerned. I'm going to grab my last commit here, and I want to show you exactly what we did, the problem that we had that we fixed. There, look at this. So descriptive. Fixes 147. It's a thing. It worked, okay? Let me click through and show you this commit. So, first thing I thought it was we were running into this, where if the badges element was null. So we capture information about the badges that folks have from Twitch IRC. And here's what Twitch IRC actually looks like. So you see things like this that are being sent from Twitch. Actually, it's not that much. Hang on. It's this. So Twitch sends this information to us on IRC inside of a stream. And what I want to do in order to identify somebody as a moderator, I want to grab the badges block. And I want to grab and identify if they have the moderator element inside there. Similarly, if you look up here, here's a badges block. This is me typing this. You can tell because it says, there it is. Here's the user, C-sharp Fritz. And it doesn't have the moderator, but I'm the broadcaster, so different. And here's Ed. Here's Ed's message about Suze is super nice. He doesn't have any badges. So a little bit of information that you can see there. And I wanted to make sure that I was capturing that so I could pass along if it was a moderator. If I didn't have any badges, well, they're not a moderator. TRCE instead of trace because they kept the prefix to 4 characters. That's what's going on there. Hey, there's our friend Julie Lerman retweeting us out on Twitter about starting. Thanks so much for the tweet, Julie. Very cool stuff. Julie has some amazing books. She's speaking at a bunch of conferences this fall. Tremendous speaker. You got to read her stuff. She's writing every month in the data column in Visual Studio. Visual Studio? No, MSDN Magazine. Hey, Return to Dust. Good to see you. Let me fire up, make sure I have my commands ready. Here's what the real problem was right here. Inside of our, and let's open up and view the whole file. When I was capturing receive messages on thread, it was not that one. Process message. We had set up down here. Let's output the badges. Great. That's for whispers. I didn't do it for the actual chat messages up here. Wah, wah. Wait a sec. I've actually got that music. So there were no badges. Now that I put that in, it knows how to pass along that information. And we can detect if somebody is, in fact, a moderator. All right. Moving on. So that's what we did there. That's how we fixed that. And now we have the shout-out capability for moderators there in the chat room. Obvious picture for badge equals null. Let's see. Now, wait a sec. Now, it... Why isn't it resolving that image for me? It should be resolving what that is. Yes. The bot should have resolved that image for us and told us what it was, but nothing. Did I break the image resolver? That's not what I want to get into today. Today, I want to finish that startup experience so that we can, for CoreWiki, so that we can select our various data configuration that we'd like. There's 5 pull requests out here. 5! That's awesome. That is phenomenal. We need to take a look. Some of these are just fixes, right? Simple little things here. They're nice. It's Argtang, Daniel, Lithix with some nice changes for us. I need to come back to this in a little bit because I want to first finish that startup experience. So let's minimize this. Let's start up the command line. Because I prefer using the command line. Because I'm a serious programmer. I use the command line for everything. Fantastic. We're all up to date. Let's start Visual Studio and go right into CoreWiki. Let's take a look-see. Alrighty, here we go. So there's my details page. When we added the ghost capabilities for the text, what the heck happened there? Okay, my video encoder just went haywire. That was weird. Let's see if we can ditch some of these other things that are hanging around. All right. Hey, Welsh Ronaldo. I'm not a serious programmer. I don't know Git well enough to use it on the command line, says Gareth. No. Honestly, I know maybe 6 different commands that I know, right? That I know by heart and that I can recite. Yeah, with the kappa. But what I focus on then is the various iterations of those. And really, git commit, git add, branch, checkout, merge, pull, push. Those are the big ones that you need to know. The ones after that, like rebase, cherry pick, they're a little further off the beaten path. And Gareth, while a little bit sarcastic, I want to make sure that folks know that there really are only about 6 different commands that you need to know to be productive. So you're right. Not knowing Git doesn't make you not a serious programmer. Rebase is a tough one. Yeah, is that, let me make sure I'm pronouncing that, is that Caliscope or is that Caliscope? And what's the cool logo you got there? Oh, H1Z1. Nice. All right. Remote add origin. Yep. Git remote. There's another good one. So you can manage your various connections out to remote services. But I don't know many people that add additional remotes besides origin. After origin, I don't think there's too many after that. Shouldn't there be a guard for when get element by ID, topic equals null. Oh man, you're already looking at my JavaScript here. No, topic will always be something here because topic is right there. It's in the same page, so we're good. But this isn't where I want to be working today. Let's jump into this. Right, so we added our ghost theme for Halloween the other day. But what I want to do is I want to focus on completing our startup experience. So our startup experience for this, if you remember, we have this challenge with CoreWiki where when you start it up, we want to be able to specify who the admin is. We want to not have a default admin account, and we want you to be able to choose your database configuration. What provider would you like to use? And we built a very simple startup screen to help facilitate that feature set. And we're just going through and we're going to set that up. We want to make sure that after you submit, here's what my settings are. We persist those settings and then flip over into standard CoreWiki operating mode. So here it is running. And we've got our cool little ghost effect because we're in the ghost theme. I'm going to go to the dark theme so I don't have that ghost effect. There it is running. And it looks fine. Because we already have the doodad running. We already have it marked as that first start configuration is completed because we hard-coded it just to get it running here. All right. Now, so first start incomplete, right? So this value defaults to true. By default, it's incomplete. It hasn't started. And then we're going to check, is the app configuration file name? Does that file exist? This is, it's, here we go. Hosting environment, content root path, app settings, app.json. So it's going to look for a file hanging next to this. Heroes of the C# bot, yeah. One day I would love to do a stream using alternative tools to see what they're like. I only seem to use VS Code, and therefore, when I have to use Visual Studio, it's fun to play with things like Vim and Emacs again and see what the editor stories are like there. Amen, Gareth, and that's what I did last month with... that was the point of things like Ubuntober and May is for Macs. Let's try out these other things. Let's see what's going on over there, learn a little bit from them, and who knows? Maybe we'll find something that we like. Woo! And we'll stick to it for a little bit. CoreWiki is so cool, you can visit this page to experience it. Yep, CoreWiki2.info, that's where it is. There we go, it resolved that page. I'm about to be hired by Shadow.Tech. Full stack engineer for a phone operator. Kaleyscope. Let's celebrate that. Congratulations to you. Well done. Best of luck to you in your new gig there. Let us know how it goes. Come back next week. Let us know that, hey, started at your new job and things are going well. And we want to celebrate those achievements. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. And hats off to you. All the best in your new job. All right. I'm not a fan of Vim plugins in VS Code as they don't let me just map a key on the fly. You can help with that with some extensions, I think. But why when you can just map... Right, you can map through Visual Studio. I mean, it's a couple more steps, but you're getting tons of productivity features out of it. All right, so now that I removed that, let's restart this and see what it looks like again. This time, I'm actually going to start it and use the .NET watch command so that we can iterate on this a little bit more quickly. So that's not how you spell .NET, Jeff. .NET watch run will watch the project, and as a C# file changes, it'll restart the run command. It'll stop and restart. Renaming variables and stuff like this is horrible. I'm so used to hitting escape. JKLAMAI. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. did I get my application for Twitch Partner to go through? So here's the deal. Let me make sure folks notice. Oh, thank you for the follow, Caliscope. I appreciate that. See the 73 here? There's a thing that happens for folks who are broadcasting on Twitch. When that number averages 75 on the month, you can become a Twitch partner, which means that things like the resolution that you see my broadcast at are always transcoded to every resolution. I get a bunch more emotes that we can put in stream. When that viewer number averages above 75 for a month, they will consider you for that partner status. With our Halloween stream, with our Thursday stream, we crossed over that by like two. So we got there. We need to keep it up now so that we can be evaluated and see that I am partner status. No mischief, Svava. Good to see you again.
Oh my.
No mischief. But I tell you, I think George is, even though I've got him turned all the way up, I feel like he's too quiet.
Wow.
I know. But oh gosh, Caliscope, thank you. I appreciate you offering to sub. Never a need to sub. We do make make those subs into donations, but I appreciate the offer. Sometimes I want to run my test key to run a specific file when I'm in an implementation file. Neat. Okay. That's interesting. So this is what our startup page looks like, and I believe it does write the file for us properly. Oops. Let's open the core wiki folder. Let me get it over here. All right, there's that folder. Now, when we key this in, so I have an administrator username, so if I key in C# Fritz and their email address, sure, let's make it that. And it defaulted my password. Database, I'm just going to choose SQLite and leave it blank for the default. And when I submit, I should get that app settings app.json. And it didn't write the file. All right. Let's dig in and see what's going on there. Let's do a little bit of debugging. Figure out why that post, it didn't write the file. What the heck? All my spacing is messed up here. Ugh. Ugh. All right. So here's the post. Should create a new admin user. Try to create the user right here. If that succeeded, add role to administrators, write config file to disk, redirect to page. All right, so we should see that happen. Yes, subbing here is pretty awesome. Subs are worth so much if you can and only if you can. Absolutely. You know, if you can, it's great. Your sub actually gets doubled and turned into a donation to folks who could use, right? It helps pay for them to learn how to write code as well. And of course, right, we saw some folks this morning use Twitch Prime. If you have an Amazon Prime account, you could turn it into a Twitch Prime and you get one channel subscription a month. All right, let's see if we can, I need to attach the debugger, which means I can't use, well, wait a sec. No. Are you kidding? Why does this keep happening? Why? Try this again. Yes, with Amazon Prime, you get to donate Amazon's money to a great cause. The build saga continues. And let's see if it actually starts this time. With the debugger attached. Come on. Make it happen. Make it happen, Cap'n. All right. Okay, so looks better. Let's make this something like that. I'm going to make this something different. I'm going to make this Fritz at corewiki.info. Password 1234. I should make it a double password key in, but we can enhance the form once we get that. Okay, I clicked submit. Where did it go? Where'd it go? Yes, that's right. I build.
And then?
Nothing happened.
And then?
I'm going to take a look at the debugger and figure out where it went. I bet you it something happened there. Let's try this again. Admin username, admin email address, Fritz at corewiki.info. I should make that email address. Something like that, like this. Submit. Okay, it didn't even hit here. So where did it go?
And then?
I don't know where it went. Reload. All right. Try this again and figure out where this thing went. Stop it. No. Go away. Email address. Try this again. Corewiki.info. Let me know if you see anything that you think it might be. Okay. That didn't look right at all. Did you see that? Like, that's weird. Calliscope says, I'm working on a Discord bot written in Node.js in microservice backend with a front-end Next.js SSR server-side redirect? Server-side rendering. Server-side rendering and debugging. It's a pain. It's not too bad. We're used to it. Is there a good case for greater than 1080 displays for a desktop for a .NET developer? The correct answer for screen size for a developer is more. MattGR23, thanks so much for using your Twitch Prime subscription. Yes, we will match that and make a donation to Girl Develop It. Thank you so much for sharing your Twitch Prime with me. And, yeah. Very cool stuff. And you get the C# bot emote that you can use anywhere you'd like here on Twitch. Yes, Chaos Theory. More dev space. Technically, my yoga is a 4K display. It's so nice, but everything's tiny because it's a 15-inch display. Now, why am I not getting this at all? Where is this actually trying to post back to? Let's take a look-see here. Because now I feel really bad. I feel like we've done something stupid here. We're no good, very bad. Form? That's not right. Look at that. No! It doesn't say form action equals post. And that needs to be a submit. Oh, God. Try this again. Come here. And no. Hey, is it the Martis live or is it the Martz live? Do you pronounce that? Let me know. I think this needs to be input type submit. And it's value equals. You think the button was fine? Hey, Jesse Skinner. Hello. You think? I don't think it... I'll leave the button the way it was. The form without it, I think, was doing a get. So let's try this one more time. Admin username is this. Fritz at corewiki.info. Let's give it a password. Long and random my foot. Let's give it that. All right. See, it's not stopping coming in. I'm going to put a break up here. See if it hits that one. Just going to click that. See, it did a get. It's doing a get. It's doing a get, not a post. Exactly. Well done, Tiago. And there's the problem. Atif Mir, hello. Yeah, I need the action there as well. Hey, The Mortis Live, thanks so much for the follow. Yeah, we're pushing towards that rainbow beard. And it's method. Did I put it backwards? Oh, you're right. Method equals post. Thank you. I don't need an action because we're posting back to the same page. Try this one more time. See if it actually hits the right one here. I'm so used to it being generated. The developer's GIF is legendary. Yes, that's why we have Steve welcome everybody by saying that, by chanting developers, developers, developers. Now I had someone suggest that I should have a Satya GIF. Oh, Kabuki. Is the rainbow beard going to include glitter? RBJ Love, thanks for the follow. Let's see how far we cross 5,000. I'm not opposed to it. I am not opposed to it. I think our friend Noopcat is going to get a little... Yeah, there you go. Stretch goal. I like it, Gareth. Well done. Points on that one. I think Suze is going to be a little weirded out by having this guy standing next to her on stage with this rainbow beard that's all glittery. Beard beads? Devin. Yeah, we're not making a Christmas tree here, folks. This is my face we're talking about. All right, let's try this one more time. And it should actually do the post back right. Right? Fritz at corewiki.info password. I'll make that a password. Database, sure, go. It still did a get. It's on the get. Why am I on the get? I don't want the get. Form method post. No, Noopcat will not have a rainbow beard. Hey, Mini Burger. I don't have that command on my chat. Is the button inside the form? Okay. You know what? Good idea. Let's check that kind of thing. It sure looks like it's inside of it. The button is right there. It's directly inside of it. I don't think type submit actually does anything. It's unfortunate. Thanks, Minnie. Minnie's one of my friends from the creative community. If you're interested in some more creative things, you can check out her stream. There you go. You can follow her at that location. HTTP versus HTTPS. No, I mean, we're not running into that. Because our action is empty string. So it should be posting back to the same page. Whatever. Timeout. That's fine. So why are we hanging? Think. Let's check out our edit page and see if there's something simple that I'm missing here. Form method equals post. Form method equals post. I'm going to get rid of the action. On the edit page, yeah, we have button type equals submit. Please tell me it's just that. Please. Cancel. Let's navigate back to this. Here we go. Restarting. So this should help us, right? This is the configure the application. fritz@corewiki.info password. Something really long and ugly. Choose a database. Nope, it's still doing a get. You make me sad. Right, if I go over to network, right? No, we did a post! The plot thickens. Is it because I don't have... I thought on... hang on a second here. On get... right, on post async. Am I... right? Public async task, I on post async. Please tell me I don't have two of these. No. What do you think, chat room? What am I missing here? I'd say be explicit with the action. Yeah, I think you're right. I think you're right about the post attribute. So what we're doing here, for those of you who aren't familiar with this, there are two ways, there are two verbs that your browser uses when connecting and working with a web server, get and post. And when you just navigate to a page, you key into your browser, www.bing.com, it's getting that web address. Well, when you click a button on a website, because you're saying post this Facebook status or post this chat message to Twitch, that's a post method. And that post verb is receiving some sort of a payload. In this case, the information that we're capturing on that form, and we want to do something with that payload. And that's what we're trying to do right here. And for some reason, it's not receiving. Since the method has the word post, it should pick it up. Yes. So I'm trying to force it now I'm being explicit about exactly which method it should use. The technology, the ASP.NET framework we're using when we're doing a get, when we first navigate, is going to use this method that's named get. It should be smart enough to say on post, when we do that post, use this method because it's receiving that post verb. So it has the smarts to say, well, is there a method here named post? And it'll go and find it and use that. So let's key this in again. Something like that. I don't care about the password right now. Sure. It did the get. It did the get. Not only did it do the get. All right, so now I'm thinking about... yeah, it's doing the get. I'm wondering about the routing. TDD this. No, I think this isn't going to be a TDD issue. TDD is test-driven development. Should we write some unit tests around this? I think what we may be running into, the next thing that this could be, is around that routing that we're doing over here. And when we're deciding where to send folks, we're redirecting them to AppStart. I'm wondering if this is happening. Let me put a break in there just to see if we're getting redirected incorrectly. The route is going to /index, so it seems it's okay. Maybe. Let's put a break over here. Let's see. Is there a way these days to view the route table? Good question, Gareth. I'm not sure. And we could do a manual post to figure it out. This is interesting, right? These little debug questions. So my request path is just slash, right? So this is where it's saying, okay, we're going to redirect you to first start. So that's correctly doing this. So now my request path is first start. And here we go, going through, and I'm getting more information redirecting to first start. What's the request that it's going to? Hang on. request favicon Ico. Interesting. So that's not getting the right information either. Okay, we're going to need to figure that out as well. The plot thickens. Whatever. All right, so here, so the request path is slash first start. And here comes the context request path is slash favico. So now it's going to redirect to first start. Kawaiti? Thank you for the follow. Now it's going to first start, which should be that index page. And I never got into the post. Hey, Mr. Regs, good to see you. Yeah, it is the browser trying to be helpful. Oh, Gareth, yes. I forgot about Steve's ASP.NET Core. Now, it's not redirecting me every time. Routes to controller. Yeah, this will show you the table. I don't want to so much look at the table as I want to know where it's trying to go. But you're right. Our routing here is a little messed up. Is a void action okay there? Yes. Yes, it is. Oh, wait a sec. Hang on. Well, not edit, index. So on post is returning. I mean, if I turn this into I action result here, right, I need to return. I don't know what's going on there. This is fine. This is just returning. That's okay. What the heck's going on? Okay. So why isn't it receiving the post? Think. Let's do that again. Are you sure it's not redirecting every time? Is the class instantiated at all? Well, all right, let's take a look at that as well. So here it's redirecting, and it's also going to choke on the fav icon. Right, so there it is. I'm doing the on get, and it's painting the page. You know what? I'm going to take context request path. Come here, you. And I'm going to pin that. Come here. No, I pinned you. There it is. So now I can just see it. There it is right there. All right. So fav icon, it's going to the wrong place. And now we're painting the screen. Good. So there it is. Something like this. I don't care about the password. We'll validate it later. Database. Yes. Go. All right. So here, the request path is first start. Let's look at that context request. Come here. And let's put that into our watch window here so we can see a little bit. That's not how you spell request. Thank you. Delete some of these other watches. All right, let's take a look-see. So it's pasting back a form. It isn't catching the method correctly, Stelzy. That's right. It's not triggering it. So there's our form. There's cookies, method equals post, and it's posting to slash first start. So it's not going to map, which means that it should go through to first start on that request. No. It went to article not found. Stop the press. That's what's happening. I want the call stack. So it's in article not found. Why is it initializing so many times? I don't. Now, here it is trying to do the fav icon. Yep, fav icon. So it never got to the post because right? Am I right that it's trying to redirect the post to the article not found page. Kawaiti says, I'm learning Python. Was wondering if people go through these stages where it feels unbearable and hitting brick walls constantly. To kind of getting what the code is saying, and now I'm at a point where I've followed someone to building a Twitter scraper post bot, and it works, and I get the code they've written, if that makes any sense. Yeah. Coding isn't unbearable for me, but I oh, yeah, it is fun when it's working. But there's challenges also when it doesn't, right? And reading other people's code is a very good skill to have. Run with that. Enjoy that. You'll have a good time. It's okay. So it's mapping when it starts with segments first start, it redirects to first start. I want it to actually return first start if you're over there. Yep, the method signature is correct. I don't think it's ever getting there. I think it's attempting. I think it's attempting to go to the page not found and getting redirected. Right. So, follow me for a second. Wow. Side straddle hops, thanks so much for the follow. I appreciate you joining us. So you can see things you might. Yes, it's okay to hit walls. That's when you need to figure out. It is posting to first start. So, right. So it should hit this and just go right to first start. What's in the pipeline before setting up the first start pipeline? What's in the pipeline is what's over here in configure routes, which is here. Startup. So we actually have a bit here that will look at the slash and we'll route out to somewhere else. but I've added the first start area. So it should go down into our area. But the redirection tells the browser to go to first start. It's not redirecting because the path starts with first start. So we're good. It's not going to redirect. Shouldn't it be context request instead of request on line 41? No, this request is the request from, it is the same request, but it's coming in from the application. We're saying run this if you're not out that. Hey, Rambling Geek. This is an interesting problem. A very interesting problem. Because it sure looks like it's conditionally redirecting to first start if first start is incomplete. Think this through. So it's going to map when. Branch the request pipeline when first start is incomplete. Yes. And it's going to say if the request does not start with first start, and it does, so it's not going to branch. And then it'll exit. Check the request method to the post method and forward to the post method if it's a post. All right, I tell you what, we'll take a look at that. So I've already got it here. Let's take a look again. And the fact that it comes back with nothing tells me something else is going on there. So the check, if the first start is complete, interferes with the post. Maybe. All right, so now I'm on the get. Right? So from here, I can say this dot isn't request context in here? Page context, HTTP context, request dot, and it's doing a get. All right. But it didn't paint the page. Let's do that again. Yep. All right, so there's the page. Key in my admin name. Whatever, sure. All right, so the request path is first start. And let's also add come on. There. Let's add the method. So I've got those two that we're watching. Let's kind of line that up if we can. Thanks so much. So we're posting to first start. This is the request. Now we're doing a get on first start. Something happened and it redirected to the get. But this didn't fire. And now we're back at the get. So, all right, now I'm going to ask a stupid question. What if we're not receiving the values properly into our post? Let's look at our index. The fields we have are Admin username, right? Admin email, admin password, database, connection string. This should be just connection string. Right, and this is trying to receive into a first start configuration object. Admin username, admin email, admin password, database, connection string. It doesn't have wiki name, but I'm okay with that for right now. Let's see if that works. Stop on the post, use F10, F11 to step around and see exactly what's happening. Fair enough, Evan. Let's see. I don't think we're interfering. Yeah, because it would hit the model state is valid. Oh, wait a sec. It's required. All right. I'll make sure I key something in there so that we get a value for connection string. That might be it. That might be it. I'm not going to shoot it down. Let me make sure I key something in there just so we can verify. All right. So there it is, doing that. First start get. There we are on the on get. Now we're getting the fav icon. Yes, thank you, browser. All right. So admin username is me. Sure, whatever. Okay. There's a thing. So it's doing a post into first start. Context request. And if we take a look at that, there's our form. Where's the data? Where's the data? I mean, right? There's nothing in the query string either. XWW form URL encoded. It should have been there. We're not even at the routes, Rambling Geek. The data is not there. Where'd it go? Is it because these are IDs and not names? Yeah, that's what I'm thinking, Niami. That's what I'm thinking is those need to be names. Right? So that it's actually passing that. And just to be doubly paranoid, let's. And the fact that we're doing these as HTML instead of using letting ASP.NET generate this for me is also a little. Right? This should be name equals database. All right, try this again. No helpers used. Yeah, input 4 should do that stuff for us. Hey, Granloff. Well, I wasn't using the HTML helpers. Okay, fav icon, there's the first start get. All right, back over to this. whatever, sure, something in there. Here's the post into first start. Oh. Where'd it go? I hit Shift F11 and it went somewhere. It's still loading. Something's happening somewhere. Is it over here? Tell me it's over here. It's not over here. It's running. It's doing something. Route matched. Yeah. Where is it? No. Now I've broken it. Try this one more time. Couldn't even see the call stack. Maybe I could have looked at it. All right. Okay, over here, try this. Yep, sure, okay, I don't care, go. That's trying to go to Favico. Trying to go to first start with a get. Interesting. It can't get to the form. There's the post. And it's hanging. Well, yeah, because I'm in the middle of this thing. And it's doing the get now. But it did do a 400. Look at that. All right, why am I getting a 400? So a 400 is a bad request. Upgrade insecure. Huh? I mean, we sent the stuff up. What additional guard least fixed point? I kind of agree, Granloff. I'm looking at the 400 here. And this feels weird. You know? Model is index model, so I should be able to say... Right, let's get rid of the type... Get rid of these. Put in ASP4 equals. Now, why am I not getting IntelliSense on that? I don't have a... I need a view imports here. View imports. Oh, come on. Right, and I'm just going to copy out the same contents that I have up here from my view imports there. I just need that one. Move it up one. Yeah. Okay. Back over here. Yeah, ASP4 knows. Yes, I know it requires a value. Thank you. I'm going to go to model dot first start config. And this is going to be the admin username. And it's not. There we go. Do the same. Don't I want ASP4 here also? At model first start config admin username. Right. For the middleware. Maybe it does not trigger the debugger. It should go to your redirect for post as it is. Let me come back to that. I'm going to finish wiring these up real quick. At model first start config. I'm actually just going to copy that. So I'm going to get rid of this. Get rid of those. ASP4 equals. And then this is, why am I not getting syntax completion? Same deal here. ASP4 equals cool. Database. Now, how do I make sure this? Now I should be able to do. Right. Let's get rid of these. ASP4 equals. Right. Cool. Right. Just to make sure that all this is being passed properly. I can get rid of that. Okay. Let's see if we get that working properly. Do you actually need the at? There are multiple forms bound to the page. No, there's one. There's only one, I thought. All right. I should put a conditional on that break. All right, so there I am in the get. Yep, fav icon. All right. Interesting. It doesn't remember all my stuff from before. And that's not a password field anymore. All right. Okay. Let's take a look and see if there's a form here. Function requires all threads to run. and we're hanging. I was not using the form tag helper. You're right. Maybe I am getting hung up in anti-forgery. But I don't think we use the form tag helper over here in the edit page either. It's just form method equals post here. I mean, it's showing up as though it's the... it is going to have it in there, but I'm not... Time for some console write line. Oh, no. Wrong answer, Fritzbot. Way off. Who knows? Why do I see give me your admin? That's an older version of this. Sequer? You're being redirected into this. What you can do to get around that, right? You're in the dev branch. If you check out the project first start branch, you'll see where we are. But these fields that we're working with here, come here, you. Input ID equals admin username. And it doesn't have a name on it. SugarSkull4, thanks so much for the follow. But it didn't make the password field. Oh, no, type password. It's a password. That doesn't make sense. No. Hang on. This isn't the same version of the page. Nuts. Get this running again. A crazy Good Friday? Do you mind if you ask a quick question? Sure, go ahead. We've got lots of friends here in the chat room that can help out as well. What's good, says Zerk. We are struggling here. Try another browser. Oh, no. Oh, no! Are you kidding me? I mean, are you really... kidding me? This is ridiculous. This is absolutely ridiculous. Yeah, I want the 21403. I heard Linux is better than for this stuff. Oh, meat popsicle. Chicken and waffles, that's what's good. Try it. Can't. Gluten. There, now it works. Try this. All right, I'm in. Admin username. Admin email address. See, password isn't a password field. Interesting, isn't it? But look at that ID name. And the name over here. That definitely tells me something. I mean, this isn't a password. We can fix that by making it, and there's our request verification token right there. So let's finish keying this in. Whatever. Yahtzee! Now we got something. Just do it right, guys. Working on the startup, what's section A, Frank? For some reason, it's not posting back and saving properly, and I think we just found what the issue is. Sugar Skull says, I'm enrolling in my programming fundamentals class, and my school offers C++ or Java. Not sure which one I should take and why. I want to eventually go into mobile app development, but also web dev and computer programs. I agree with Tiago there. C++ is a lower level language. It's much more complex because you'll be managing memory and processor interaction directly. It means you get a lot more power in how you write your applications. And that's something that game developers really, really want. So if you're interested in going into game development, I cannot recommend C++ enough. However, mobile app development, particularly Android, is natively written in Java. So if you're interested in looking at mobile app development, Java is a pretty good way to go. You're going to eventually want to take a look at Objective-C, which is a little bit like C++ and a little bit like Java. It's a little bit in between the two, not quite the same. You may even want to check out Swift. But as a good foundation for objective programming, object-oriented programming, not objective, object-oriented programming, Java, you can't go wrong with. And that's what I would suggest. The field password, you have it, type text. I think you're right. Uptime, yep. How long have I been a streamer? Asks Codair. November 21st is my one-year streamer anniversary. Streamerversary? Streamerversary? Something like that, yeah. So I would lean towards Java. It runs on a billion devices. It's out there. Kotlin runs on Android, but the two choices are C++ or Java. So I'm going to lean towards Java in this case. Is that Gilles Gougou? Thanks so much for the follow. That doesn't mean potato. You're welcome, Sugar Skull. Make sure you stop back. Let us know which one you choose. Let us know how you do in your class. And we'll be here a couple days a week writing some code. Swift has been awarded for one of the best languages. Super paranoid. Thank you for the follow. Why is it one of the best languages? They've rewritten it, literally completely rewritten it three times. News punt. Come on, I'm waiting for it to appear. There it is. Thank you for the follow. Actually enrolling right now. All right. I think they compared it to Objective-C. Crumbs. Anything's better than Objective-C. Objective-C is a leftover from Next that folks, yeah, had a real problem with. All right. So I think we found a couple of our issues here. Let me go back to first start configuration. The admin password we have marked as required, we should also mark it as a password so that it treats it as a password. That's... Huh? Isn't there a... DevXer, hello. Just coming info, David Fowler, XAML, field ceremony. I need some help with that. Jobs resurrected, Objective-C. I'm looking for the password attribute. I want to decorate this. And mark it as a password. No, that's not it. Right, because if we go up here and we take a look at identity, pages, account, and if we say, like, reset password, here we go. Input for input dot password. This is coming out of the reset password model. Da-da-da, input model. Data type password. That's what I'm looking for. When in doubt, there's configuration somewhere else that you can, or code somewhere else that you can copy. Maybe even in your own application. Yeah, Frank. Look at this. Oh my gosh, Frank Turkan. Oh my gosh. Well done. Thank you. They have a Python class as well. Sugar Skull, thanks so much for bringing your Twitch Prime subscription here. That is awesome. Thank you so much. you're going to get the C-sharp bot emote, just like Ginescu used up there. And we're going to make a donation to Girl Develop It so that ladies, women, underserved minorities can learn how to write code in classes, just like we're doing right here. I can't believe we're almost at 4,200 followers. Holy crow. There you go. Look at that. Tiago has the higher level subscription and can use this wonderful mug. All right. So that's going to fix that password rendering. And I'm also running into, what was the error that it threw? Right here. Value cannot be null. And it's that right there. It didn't receive it properly somewhere. Hey. What do you mean wonderful isn't the word you would use?
Throw me a freaking bone here.
I mean, come on, Tiago. All right, let's try this again. Blazor is nice with the login. Okay. You said it a long time before, Turrican says. Wrong model binding. Yeah. We had the wrong field names in there. So they weren't being bound properly. You're right. So I'm going to take these breakpoints off here. Let that go through. I'm going to take it off the get as well. Over here. All right. Admin username. Which, there we go. Sure. That's better. Database, sure. I don't care about the connection string. There we go. Model state is valid. True. Okay. So we're creating a new CoreWiki user with this admin user. Where did it go? I'm binding it. So I should be receiving it in, and when I look at it, everything's null.
And then?
We do some more debugging.
And then?
Oh, Turrican.
And then?
No, and then.
And then?
We're going to fix this. That's what, and then. Names will be incorrect on form. Well, let's take a look at the form. Count six. Yeah. Let's take this and throw it over here into the watch so we can spelunk down it. Keys, six keys. There we go. First start config, admin username, admin email, admin password. So that should have bound into this. Right, so there's my keys. Why don't I have values? Why do I have files? Why do I have files? But I mean, there's the values, right? Sugar Skull, take C-sharp, 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 take C-sharp. Trust it from somebody who has that in his name. C-sharp. Is there any need for the start config? It's a view model. It's a view model. What's the benefit of C-sharp? Glad you asked. It works literally everywhere. You can write it on the server. You can use it to do artificial intelligence. You can use it to do machine learning. You can use it on the client, building Windows apps. You can use it to build Mac apps using Xamarin Forms. You can use it to build mobile applications using Xamarin. You can build for iOS and Android. You can use it to build things for your Raspberry Pi. Like this one. You can use it for your watch. Everywhere. Literally, C-sharp. It's like American Express. It's everywhere you want to be. Python's better for machine learning. Python is where the machine learning folks are starting. You can also use it on Samsung smart TVs. You can use it on toasters. You can use it on deep fat fryers. You can even julienne fry. No, you can't use it on deep fat fryers. You can use it on the Xbox One. ML.net, says Cam. That's where I was going to point. Serverless with Azure Functions. It's so amazing and so flexible. Operators are standing by. Use it to look cool at a party. Put it on your business card. No, don't do that. I don't have other C-sharp things here in my room. My C-sharp books are behind me and behind the green screen. Your bot runs JavaScript. Fantastic. Not a scam. Nope, not a scam at all. You don't get sued for using it. That's a good one. Tagmerzai, thanks so much for the follow. I appreciate you joining us. Build drone toaster with Meadow Board. Hey, that's a good one, Devin. ML.net's coming up to speed, but what's interesting about ML.net, that's the new... Oh, there you go. And Unity, use it to build games with C#. Unity is the framework that was used to build Pokemon Go and Hearthstone. So there's a number of other games out there, but those are two really big ones that I'm sure you've heard of. Okay. C# will get you better practices. Yes. Was Angry Birds written with it? But ML.net is actually taking some of the artificial intelligence and machine learning things that the folks on the Bing team have been working on and makes it available now open source for everybody to use. iOS and Android with Xamarin? Absolutely. Whatever language framework was used to write Fortnite, just don't. Yeah, I can... Okay. Oh, come on. I mean, Fortnite's a big deal now. Okay, so for some reason, it didn't bind this object. Like, it didn't load up those things, even though I did ASP4s on all the stuff. Easy to learn, hard to master. You sound like my... that's right, Fortnite uses the Unreal Engine. Let's take a look here. In the edit, it just says, now, somebody was saying this earlier, do we really need at all that stuff? That's just referring to the object inside of this. I'm wondering if the same thing's going on here. So where I have at model first start config, can I get away with just saying first start config? Can I do that? Right, is this literally Jeff doesn't know how to write Razor? Please tell me that it's that and we just made a stupid mistake when we built this page. Swift isn't an object-oriented. It's a multi-paradigm language. Yes. You have your choice. The sarcasm starts to rub off. See, I've got two daughters. So it's not sarcasm. It's just... It's girls being girls. And I do not... want to get in the middle of those. As a father, I stay away. All right, now do we have our object loaded? Is it valid? Is it valid? Is it safe? Okay, it is valid. All right. Do we have admin username? No. Didn't load any of that stuff. If we take a look at the form, yep. First start config admin username. So that should have certainly bound properly. Father of a soon-to-be 16-year-old girl. You're 1 year up on me, Robert Tables. That's next time. That's next year for me. Do I have from body on the action method parameter? I don't have a parameter here. I'm binding the property up here. Right? So, looking back at edit, if we use that as our template, right, on post... We don't do anything, but our article is here and it's being bound. And then looking at the page, right, Yeah. So something's happening and it's... the model binder is not binding it. Let's... do something like that and see if we can just force it to happen. Already 16 and asking for the keys to the car? No! Oh, don't do that to me. Remove the first start in the HTML inputs. Now they have to be there. Dude, I had to repair drywall. The oldest one decided to kick because he was mad at me. Yeah, I've been there too. Whatever, something here. All right, did this receive? That didn't receive anything. It put it into this thing. It tried to, and it didn't bind anything into it. Why? Oh, look at that. Is valid false? IT girl 93. All right. IT girl, you've got a winner nickname there. Well done. Well done. That's a great avatar, IT girl 93. Thanks for joining us. I look forward to seeing you in the chat room. But now it the model is not. Well, right, because this thing doesn't, nothing came in there. I have a feeling that's what's happening there. But when I look at this, right, it's first start config and then all these objects. Which lines up with how we did this over here. Right, ASP4 article.topic. The article is the name of the property over here. Is that Shiden? Yes, this is C sharp. We're using, this is ASP.NET Core. We're writing some C sharp here, and then we have a template. This is called a Razor template that has some directives that we can use to help format our HTML that we're going to output to the browser. Oh, Jesse took off. He's trying Cypress. Neat. All right. No, I didn't look at the middleware. I'm actually through to a point where I've got the form data coming in, but it's not binding to my object. Which is weird. Right, why, I mean, so we know that this doesn't work. Let's get rid of that. But why isn't it binding? Think. Why isn't it binding to this? I mean, and the model state should be invalid, to be perfectly frank, because the those required fields aren't completed. Public setter. Are you kidding me? Niami. Woo! Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I think that's it. We were missing a public setter. What the heck? Come on. Load. Do the thing. I don't care. True. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. I need to...
Right. Wow.
It can be done exactly how I want it.
No, because I got it wrong. I'm trying to celebrate here. I'm looking for... Do I have fireworks or something? Give me something. That's not what we're... No, that's not it either. No, that doesn't work either. Anything? Theme music? Do we have something here? No. I've got the Brady's. No, that doesn't work. Oh my gosh. Shiden, thanks so much for the follow. Yeah, woohoo is right. That's more of... No, that's... Yeah. Can I... Oh, wait. I can layer my Ric Flairs. Let's do this. So now I can do... Okay, that's too much. I'm sorry. Zombie slaying with a lawnmower gif. Sounds like Breaking Bad. I do have Breaking Bad.
It can be done exactly how I want it.
It can.
The only question is, are you the man to do it?
Oh, no. Because if I was, I would have done it right the first time. All right, so now we're going to try to create the user. Really? Try to create the user. If it succeeded, yes. Add them to the role. Yeah, okay, whatever. Write the config file to disk. Yeah. Yeah. Wait, something failed there. Something failed. Authorization failed. That's an authorization service. We might... Nope. That's a... Is that the same page we were working on? No. Did it really work? It might have actually worked. It might, like, have really worked.
Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Oh, my.
Do it live!
We did do it live. We got it. Okay, okay, okay. Hang on, hang on, hang on, hang on, hang on, hang on, hang on. Delete. Yes. Try this again. Ship it. I think we might be able to. Maybe. Maybe. There's one piece left after we put this in that we're going to need to address. And then we can figure out configuration stuff later. Let's go Fritz at corewiki.info. Password, I will make my something like that. And then submit. Okay. Did it go somewhere? It didn't go anywhere. Why didn't it go anywhere? Right, is it valid? Yes. There it goes. And it went through to this. Okay, okay. Now, we'll figure out the confirm password. Let's just get it working and we'll make it look cooler. We're almost there. We've almost got it. So it is loading. It is showing. And it did save my content properly. So now there's a couple different things that we should do at some point. Things like validate the database connection string. Confirm the password, like Frank is saying. But I'm just trying to get this last piece here where now we have the provider and the connection string. let's actually, like, write the, let's actually start consuming that from the application. So we're going to need to reload configuration for the application so that it's using that instead, right? Make sense? That's one good thing about C#. VS has way more support for it than for F#. Yeah, there's... It's unfortunate, but true. But we... All right. So we save this. What I should be doing now is when I finish here, right? After we write the config file to disk... Come here. We should reload configuration here. Should you use the snapshot config to auto reload? I was thinking about that. So if we go back over and let's take a look. You might be onto something. That might be the easy way to go here. So if we configure database, we need to get the we need to add that configuration. We need to, right, there's iConfiguration. If we're going to get the options snapshot for it, we need to load it. Right, we need to tell it about the new page, which is app settings, app JSON. Do I have that referenced anywhere else? Aha! And we have it marked as optional. Yes. Reload when that file changes. All right, let's see if we can. I'm going to delete that file. And I'm going to go over to the details page. I think we receive configuration in here, don't we? No, we don't. Not yet. What was that? Something just happened. Oh, and there goes patch and switch. All right. So when it reloads it, can I have a callback when it reloads? File provider, no. Rats. So when it... I'm over here in index. But configuration was passed into me. Can I also receive the iService collection and get a new instance of configuration? That feels weird. Yeah, service provider. Create that as a read-only property. Right, so after I've written that out, it should reload it, right? So if I say service provider get service, iConfiguration. Now I should be able to inspect it here, and it should have stuff in it, right? Debug. Give me that. Right, and we're writing config.database provider. We should see that. What happened? Went somewhere I was not expecting. Do you have your config typed? You would need to inject I option snapshot. I do not. Is get service? It is. I'm only doing this to kind of force the situation. What I'm looking at is, right, I told it add JSON file, reload on change. So, right, it's being loaded for me right there. So it, right, it should do it, right? In fact, here, let's do this. I'm going to F1 on that just so we can look at the docs. When in doubt, as a developer, look at the docs. I want this one. Whether the configuration should be reloaded if the file changes. There we go. Right, so that should reload. So what I'm going to do, just to verify that it is reloading, is I'm just going to grab it here. I should, as I configuration. Is creating a file considered a change? Yes, because it's empty. It's not written there on disk. Create a POCO for your settings and use iOptions or iOptions snapshot. Do I really need to do that? It should reload it, right? Why is this semi? Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I'm going to put a breakpoint right there. Let's see what happens. I shouldn't have to do an iOption snapshot, right, if it's reloading. And I'm actually grabbing the configuration. It should be reloading that itself. Let's see what we get. We are 3 followers away from 4,200. I think I may stick around here. It'll make me 5% more awesome. Niami!
Wow.
How to Slav? Thanks so much. Pudada Paman. Thanks so much for the follow. One away. Thanks so much, How to Slav. Oh, wait, put my browser over here. Let's try this again. No, you're not going to be able to trick it like that. It's smart. Try that. Tom McHugh, you can't fool it either. The Tom McHugh. Speedrunner, let's do a shout out to Tom McHugh while we're here. Right? Random. Yeah. Tom speedruns video games, and he's really good at Kingdom Hearts. Am I going to sell out when I hit 4,200? No. No. Let's call it Fritz at JeffreyFritz.com. Sure, whatever password. I don't care. Something else down here. Okay. Model state is valid. Good. Create the user. All right. So, did we get a config? We did get a config. So, config database provider. No. Didn't get it. Didn't reload it. I think I have to reload it. I do. Maybe Tom McHugh. Maybe you were 4,200 right there. Look at that. Wow. There you go. 4,200. Closer and closer to the rainbow beard. Nice. Thank you so much. Have a nice weekend. Yes, I will be streaming tomorrow. Yeah, put some hype there in the chat. Absolutely. So it didn't reload the configuration for me. Hyorian, thank you for the follow. I appreciate you joining us. That should flip to 4,201, right? I'm looking at my gauges here. Fantastic. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us. There's Johan. Hey there. So why didn't it reload? Right? I told it reload on this one. Right? inside program here. So we're going to need to figure that out, why that doesn't reload. Hey, Bokyo. Right? The reload on change isn't... add JSON file reload on change. Let's see if somebody's talking about this, because it sure doesn't... Yeah. How does that work? Because it sure doesn't look like it's doing it. ASP.NET configuration. Yeah. What's the question? I'm using app settings JSON and reload on change true. In both, I have reload on change set to true and injected it using iOptions. Well, it's only supported in 1.1. It's actually iOptions snapshot you want. So that's saying it did it. Oh, there is a little bit of a delay. There you go. Streamlabs links a bit behind. This actually, neither one of these is Streamlabs that you're seeing. That's me. But it also didn't update on the Twitch dashboard that I have here as well. So this is saying we need to be using iOptions snapshot. But I mean, configure app configuration, right? Command line configuration. No. Any configuration. Ugh. Okay. Twitch capacity being used up by all the beta testers of Squad Streams. Nah, Squad Streams isn't available yet, and I am on the beta test list. I made sure of that. I've actually got some phone calls with those folks coming up. Oh, it's coming. Let's see here. Whether the configuration is reloaded, if the file. Okay. Yeah, yeah. JSON configuration provider is established first. Call configure app configuration when building the host to specify the app's configuration for files other than app settings JSON and app settings environment JSON. So I think that's what's going on there. Thank you, Heorian. Yeah. I think it might be the absence of the file the first time. Could you create an empty? Well, so here's what I'm thinking, Niami. And let me know if I'm pronouncing that right. If we're not right, where am I? Configure app configuration, and we're adding it, right? Configure app configuration. Yeah. And I'm adding it here. So it should get loaded. Close enough? Oh, come on. Help me out there. Niami? Hold on to your hats. Look who's here. Right in the nick of time.
Oh, my.
Glenn? You're going to save my bacon here. Help me out. Here's what we've got. We are writing... We're in the middle of building this first start experience. Let me back up and show you how this works. So we're building this first start experience where I want you as a user inside of CoreWiki to be able to specify what database provider you're using when you first start. And here's the database connection string. And right now, I don't care. We'll wire this up in a bit. And that's actually what we're trying to do. And I know that won't go anywhere, but we'll fix that later. Anyways. So when you select it from our user interface over here, we actually write a file to disk that has just those user-defined settings. We're writing it to a file called appsettings.app.json. And what we're doing when we write out this file is we're hoping to get it reloaded into our configuration. Now, our configuration... inside of program is being set up, configure app configuration, app settings, app JSON. And we're loading it and we're specifying, right, the last boolean here is true, because that's reload on change. So we want to see when this file is created that it loads it, because the file's now there. But we're not seeing it load. We're right, just to try and test this out, right after we write that file out, I'm going and grabbing configuration and saying, well, did we actually write that? Do we have that database provider loaded? And this came back null. Do I have a core wiki hat? I think we need to do that before the year, the year streamiversary. Tom McHugh asks, have I ever seen Kit Boga? Yes. He uses a ton of custom-made bots tools, more than any streamer I've come across. So Kit's very interesting, and Kit actually writes code using .NET on Sunday nights. Kit sets up a honeypot. He sets up a virtual machine with a bunch of .NET tools to make it look very appealing to scammers, phone scammers, folks that claim to be from Microsoft. Here's the thing. Kit's using some older tools. He's using some techniques and things that as a Microsoft developer community member, I want to help him out with. And I tried to reach out with him and say, hey, I actually work at Microsoft and I'd like to help you. And of course, he was a bit skeptical because everybody who calls him works at Microsoft. And even offered some assistance, and yeah, Kit turned it down. And Devin does phone stuff too. He's very funny. Does it work if the file exists and you change it? First thing, I don't know if it detects the file not existing. There are limitations in the file watchers. Is the DI returning the old object instead of reloading? These are good points. These are very good points. Let's stop this. Right now, my first start... where's my extension? I don't need that. Let's start off with these empty, just to make sure there's something there. Okay. So I have this extension method that actually injects by testing to see if the file exists. So now if we're going to say the file does exist, we should test to see if configuration has those settings. In which case, I need to pass iConfiguration into here. This dot configuration, that's not how you spell configuration, equals that. And I should just get rid of that because this is a static. No, rats. Let's make this a private static I configuration called configuration. There we go. That goes away. So now I should be able to come down here and during is first start complete. Just to see if this isn't. There we go. Instead of that. And I want to wrap that with a string is null or empty. Right, and so if first start is incomplete and the string is null or empty, it is incomplete. Return it. Otherwise, it's false. Okay, good. So now we're checking to see if it's incomplete and we're going to return it. I'm actually thinking of using the hashtag to start off. I want to use C# to start off my programming career. Fantastic! C# is very good for a whole bunch of different tasks. We just had a conversation about that a few minutes ago, and you happen to be in a chat room with a bunch of folks who really like C#, F#, and a bunch of those .NET languages. So I think you're in good company. There's a lot of projects out there that you'll be able to find and be successful with. Let me pass configuration into this now. There we go. Lycan1534 asks, I've been looking at trying to figure out some .NET Core and ASP.NET Core certifications, but have been unable to find any other than the Azure ones, which my company doesn't use. Trying to get promotions at work, and next step is getting some certs. I don't know about the certifications for ASP.NET Core. That's a good question. It's been SQL only for 6 years. Oh, Tom. But you know what? SQL makes the world go round. So many people use SQL. All right, let's fill this in and see if we can trigger Fritz at, I don't care because I'm not actually using this. Password is something that looks like that. Database, sure, and we'll figure that out later. Submit. Now I want to see it get down into here. Okay, creating the user. App settings, app JSON was reloaded, was changed. There it is. It did write that out properly. Now, did it actually get my config reloaded? Nope. Nope. Just the concept and language, but what I do. Yeah. We need to receive an iOption snapshot. So instead of get service type of iConfiguration, grab an iOption snapshot? All right, let's do that. iOptions snapshot. Yup. Come on. Oh, I need to give it a type, don't I? Rats. What can I give it type of? Hello from Clark.io. Hey there. Did you not believe me? No. Okay, Naomi has done an amazing job today. Picking this up. Make a new type to represent my config. My configs. It's. Okay. All right. So let's create a type for this. But that is sitting inside of the. Okay. All right. I'm not going to create. Let's put it next to this. And just to get it started, public class, let's call it user app config. And it has a string, database provider, has another string for connection string. Let's take this, move it out to its own file. And go back to Is it going to be in program? No. Where did we go here? Service configure my options configuration. Let me do that. Oh, crap. Let me do that in first start config. Here. Right, so I've already put it in here and I've already done this, but I've got services right there. Services add new. Services configure. Ha ha! User app config. I don't really have any options, right? I'm passing in that configuration, right? No, I need to give it a mapping to that, don't I? Gluten-free pancakes. Yes, I am allergic to gluten. You are correct. What am I doing wrong here? Why am I blanking on this? Right, I'm doing services configure. The action to configure the options. Yeah, okay. Right, so so if I say config, right, config is the user app config. So if I say config.database provider equals configuration database provider, like that, right? Connection string equals configuration. It should pick that up automatically, right? We'll map on convention. Name should match. That's what I thought, but it's looking for a thing here. Right? Look at that. The action used to configure the options. And I don't see any sample code that shows how to do this. But yes, what's with the, yeah, gluten-free pancakes, almond pancakes are good, sure. Configure services versus configure, no. I've done something like this before, but. Right, I'm trying to add. It's in the DI namespace. Should be able to just give it config. No. No, it's not. Configure, post configure, configure options. That worked. Register a type that will have all of its. What the heck does that mean? Your local kiosk got robbed today. Oh no. See, but I don't have it in a section. I mean, I'd have to put it in a section. Not terrible. I mean, if I write and right, it wants an action if I do configure. What is that, Lemon Android? No. All right. Yeah, the get section configure doesn't do that. Even if I pass in config dot, right? Configuration dot, there is no root. See, it's changed. It's not the same. You actually have to tell it. No. No, it's. So there's also configure options. Register is a type that will have all of its configure options registered. And if I do that, right, I can pass in the type. Right, at which point over here, I option snapshot. What was it? User app config. At which point I should be able to say. Now, wait a sec. Config dot value dot database provider. Configuration.bind. I don't know about that one. And I wanna finish up here so that we can hand off to Ed, who's over there. Come on. No, I configure options or I post configure options. All right, so that doesn't work. So you're saying configure.bind? Attempts to bind the given object instance to configuration values by matching. That's not going to register it with the DI. Yeah, we're supposed to be able to register this. Right, so reload on change doesn't actually reload. Right? This is not the only thing to do here. Okay. Which then means services configure. Yeah. Let's see what Padatapaman has there. Configure my options with delegate. Now, this is what I started doing. That's what I started doing. I'll services.configure user app. Right, and if I say config, hey, Vindicator Vef, thanks so much for joining us. Configuration database provider. See, but that configuration object isn't being reloaded. Yeah, it's not pulling the configuration. I tried services configure configuration. That's not the signature anymore. It doesn't work. What it wants there is an action. To reload, you got to use iOption snapshot. Yes, it does. How do you get it into the iOption snapshot? That's the problem. What the? Noodle4k, thank you for the follow. So if I do this, this configuration object hasn't been reloaded. How does it know to pull this from somewhere and get it reloaded? There's a callback piece that I'm missing here. Right? And this is hard coding to specific things. Bind options to a subsection of the option app settings JSON. That doesn't work either, because even if I change this to configuration get section, fine, that's a configuration section. If I were to give it a string, It's not an action. You need to give it an action. It does not take a section. This does not work anymore. So, yeah. What version am I using? I am so glad you asked. I am looking at 2.1.3. So, and if I were to drill down on those dependencies, right, I could really get down into this. But these are all going to be 2.1.3 the whole way down. Yep, does not work like that. Not anymore. Right, and if I try to run that, it's not going to. Yep. And yeah. I don't remember us changing this, but I can still see this in source. Extensions, options, configuration, extensions. So this is under Microsoft Extensions Dependency Injection. Let me add the namespace. It's already there. Services I configuration. Yeah. Service collection configure. And I am looking at service collection configure. Yeah. I have a different summary popping up here. Look at the summary that's popping up. Where'd it go? Register is an action to used to configure a particular... these are all run before post-configure. Nope. That's not in this file. Check if you have services add options. Sure do. So I have a type of options and then a name of the options instance. And that returns an options builder. Okay, so let's do it. So let's try this user app config. And then if I say configure, it still wants an action. Action, 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 action. Yeah, it wants all actions to come in there. So that doesn't work anymore. But this is Microsoft Extensions options. The version that we're, and this is from 2.1. Sure looks like that API changed. So it routes to services, configure, options, default name, config. Yeah. Yeah, I don't have this syntax. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4 overloads on configure with an options type. I've got 2. Yeah. It's an extension, Microsoft Extensions configuration. There it is. Sephiroth, thanks so much for the follow. you're using it on 2.2, 2.1, and 2.0. Okay. Tell you what, let's... I've got the reference here because I'm seeing these. I mean, they're there. Right? If I go over to... let me go over to my startup. If I go configure database, now I've got 6. Oh, the plot thickens. All right. Is there, hang on, you are in options, configuration, extensions. The Bandit Dave. Hey, thanks so much for the follow. Microsoft extensions. Let's just start there. What the heck is this? None of those are called Microsoft extensions. Why am I finding... Hang on. NuGet. Okay. Dot options. Configuration extensions. It's this isn't installed. Neither is Microsoft Extensions Options, for that matter. And let's put down this one explicitly as well. No, configure options didn't work. It was missing a thing. Yeah, I know. I'm over here. I've got those. Now I've got the 6. There it is. So if I go user app config and pass it configuration, that should... Right now in my index, right, I'm getting I option snapshot. It should reload it. Let's see if it works. Where'd it go? Oh, it's still building. Quick delete. Let's see. Everything's an extension these days, which makes testing really, really, really hard. Let's try this. I don't care. Sure. Is it valid? Yep, of course it is. Create that user. Reloaded that. Nope, didn't reload the provider. I mean, let's try and get it again. Nope, didn't get it. Yeah, when you call configure, it does add options. Hey, talk to me, Gooseman. I could create a section in the config, but then I'm modifying the base application configuration. Which I'm almost at the point of doing now anyway. But I'm, yeah, these options are not reloading. And, yeah. But we do have it saving, right? And by restarting the application now, it should jump right into normal. I think it is. I think it is very chicken in the egg, yeah. Hey, Malfunked. Good morning. Oh my gosh, Fairy Wings was so happy to see you, Malfunked. Thank you so much. Yeah, so now it works because I have the file content written and I'm able to navigate around and I've got the stuff, but I had to restart. I don't want to have to restart. I should be able to force that data into configuration and it just works. I'm Stelzy, we can reconcile that later. The problem is it's not reloading. In my case, it's not reloading. It wouldn't surprise me if the options will only be changed when a scope is created. don't need to worry about that. Oh, thank you, Malfunked. It was great to meet so many cool folks at TwitchCon. I learned a lot. It's DI magic that it takes advantage of. Ah. Options are created, computed once per request when accessed and cached for the lifetime of the request. It's meant as soon as changed or the next request after change. That's scoped. Interesting. So on my index page here, let's do this. Let's go to my details page. And let's say at inject I options snapshot user app config. And user app config is actually, come on, where is it? CoreWiki.firststart. Put that in front of it like that. And let's put that into user config. And I don't care. I'm just trying to put something on the page to show this. Dot value database provider. So now if I go back, let's stop this. I've got to do this integration test again. Back into here, delete the provider, restart. But after modifying a config, there's a redirect, right? Yes. That request will be a new DI scope as a new request. Yes, so it should reload the config when it gets to that other place. Right, so now we're going to get into first start. Yep. Whatever. I don't care. Sure. Yes. Something. Okay, so it wrote it out. Got it. Got it.
Oh my.
Wow.
We got it. All right. So what did we learn here today? Oh man. All right. Let's wrap things up. Let's close this down. Let's wrap things up, because man, we got a lot done. So I don't need this little bit in here. We can get rid of this, save that. We can go back to my details page. Let me get rid of that inject and that extra data. All right, I'll get rid of the inject. Actually, I can reset that page if I wanted. All right, so we learned how to get the configuration loaded, injected, and we're doing it from a third-party library. Persistence is the lesson. Yes, Ancient Coder, I completely agree. The feature works. We need to finish checking and putting a little bit of validation into that page, but otherwise it works, it loads properly, and we can wire that up to our database connection now, and we're going to be in great shape. Stop the madness, says Raven Thor. I think we are in really good shape here with this now. Completed writing configuration and reloading for the application. Now what we need to do is we need to make sure that we're loading that appropriately into our database configuration. We're consuming that properly, and then we'll have all of our stuff loading and driving off of wherever that configuration is. And I think we had some great comments there about should that really reside in our separate app JSON like we have here, or do we put it directly into app settings JSON? And I think that's a very good question that we will figure out tomorrow. Here's what I'd like to do before we sign off. Let's go see if Ed is still going with his Blazor show that he's working on right now. Let me just peek in over there, see if he's still alive. Yes, he is. No. Yes, it's called Neural November. I am going to warn him. Incoming raid. Here's what I'd like you to do. If you are a subscriber, get your C-sharp bots ready, and let's get ready to head over to Ed's and drop a raid on him so that everybody knows that you came from here. Let me make sure I spell his name right. There it is. So Ed's talking about Blazor. What? What do you mean I cannot raid that channel? It's right there. Sure I can. It's telling me I can't raid it. Let's see. Yeah, it looks like he's got raids blocked. Oh no. Yeah, I can't. He's only got a few people watching him. Oh no, Ed. Let's see here. Yeah, we could raid Clark.io. But Ed was here earlier, and I wanted to support him because he was doing the thing here. He was visiting with us, talking with us. Mario, you went silent on me. There we go. Let's try this one more time, see if he put it on. There we go. Now we got the raid set up. If you want to hang out, go over and catch Ed. He's going to be talking about Blazor and about neural networks, machine learning. Get ready to head over there. Have a good time. And I'll be back tomorrow. And we'll finish wiring up and doing some more editing on this. Alrighty? Take care. We'll see you then. Have fun over there and say hi to Ed for me.
Let's try to...